So welcome. For those of you who have never met me, my name is Terry Hugo. I am AEPI's Assistant Director of Communications. So I'm in charge of all of the email marketing for AEPI, as well as social media marketing and a bunch of other different projects and things. But those are kind of my main focuses. So I'm happy to have you guys here today. I'm excited to talk about, you know, parent and alumni newsletters. I do want to let you guys know right off the bat that I'm probably going to focus solely on alumni newsletters today, but everything that we talk about for alumni newsletters are just as applicable for parent newsletters as well. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask those throughout the presentation at the end in the chat box, or you can email me personally if you end up wanting to be able to talk about stuff that we don't get to discuss today. But it should be a pretty easygoing webinar for most of you guys. I'm just gonna kind of breeze over a couple of things. The session is recorded, so if you miss something, you can go back and listen to it. It'll be on our YouTube page by the end of the week. So just look out for that. And then I see that Andrew just came in. Andrew, just to let you know, I'm letting everybody have permission to be able to talk in case you guys wanna answer some of the questions that I ask. I'll kind of like...
I'm spiking right now, so I don't think I can do that.
Okay, no worries. Thanks, Andrew. I'll go ahead and mute you then. So I'll go ahead and, like I said, after this presentation's over today, I'll be sure to send some of the materials that I talk about, some of the things I discuss and show you through shared screen via email, so you guys can see that later. But the first thing I want to start it with is, did you guys know that AEPI International offers a free newsletter service to you guys? We can create newsletters for you guys if you provide us the materials. You got to provide the content, we'll build it for you and send it to your chapter alumni for you. So I think that's a pretty cool service that headquarters offers for you all. I don't get a lot of chapters that utilize that every semester, maybe a handful of about 5 or 6. But it's really hit or miss. So I'm kind of hoping to be able to build that up over the semester and really get some of you guys started with your first newsletter and kind of get into the flow of making newsletters with you guys. So some things that I wanted to kind of discuss today, and I'll start with, if you guys aren't the alumni chair, which Dylan, I know you're not because you're currently master, but I don't know about the rest of you. If you're not the alumni chair, I think the first thing, the first step in kind of creating a newsletter is finding an alumni chair to be able to take on that position and take on the responsibilities. I don't think it should be the master. It could be the lieutenant master, but he's already got enough going on with the rest of his minor board. So if possible, if you can, and you have a chapter brother who's looking for something to do in the chapter, I highly suggest that you find someone in the chapter to take on alumni chair. And that doesn't have to be just one person. It can be multiple people. It could be, you know, a committee of people. Maybe different people are assigned to different things with the alumni chair, but let the alumni chair be the person who figures that out. Definitely identify one person, though, to start by taking over. I think the second thing that you need to consider when it comes to your chapter newsletters is the frequency of how often you guys want to send these newsletters out to your parents and your alumni, whoever your audience members might be. A lot of chapters are really quick to say that, you know, the newsletter should be monthly or, you know, every quarter. Quarterly would probably be the most I would suggest doing a newsletter. Usually I see semesterly, so chapters will choose to do it once every semester. That tends to be the most popular choice, but by all means, you can do quarterly. My only piece of advice when it comes to newsletter frequency is just decide what you have content to sustain for a newsletter. If you don't have enough quality content to sustain a newsletter monthly, then it might not be best for you to do a monthly newsletter. If you're struggling to find content every month to throw in, then maybe think about doing it once every other month, or like I said, once every 3 months. So that's 4 times a year. But that's just kind of my suggestion. Again, you guys can do whatever you think is best, and you know, headquarters is here to help you with building that newsletter. But I just want to make sure that it's the most successful newsletter for you and your chapters. I don't want you guys struggling to put things together and you're coming up with things last minute because you don't have anything for it. So after you think about identifying your alumni chair and then you think about frequency, I think the next thing you have to consider is the content. And we'll talk about the in-depth stuff of content in a little bit. I wanted to cover that after I go through the steps of submitting everything to me for a newsletter. But basically, what you want to think about for content is kind of what relates to your chapter. Every chapter is different. So while we're all the Jewish fraternity and we're all a part and a branch of the Jewish fraternity, that's a great identity to start off of. I think we all have different identities as chapters, different brands, if you may. But think about what your brand is as a chapter. Are you involved in philanthropy more? Are you involved with your academics more? Is it intramural sports that's really popular for your chapter? Decide what things and pieces are most important to your brothers and what you think that your alumni and parents and audience members might find interesting the most, and then develop content off of those things. Don't try to make yourselves look like something you're not, because then the content that you try to give off in your newsletter isn't going to be genuine and it won't be interesting to your audience members. They're not going to care. So just keep that in mind when you're thinking of content. And again, I'll get into some specifics of what types of content I usually see in newsletters in a minute, and I'll show you examples of other newsletters I've made. The next thing that you have to do after you think of all the content is you have to write it up. And again, I'm going to show you some examples of like ways I would like you to write it up in just a second. But basically, you'll write all the content up in whatever format it is, whether it's a Word document or a Google Doc that you share with me. And then after you write all the content up and it's completed, you'll go ahead and share that with my email, which is thugo@aapi.org. And I'll make sure to give that to you guys again later if you need it. But you'll share that content with me, and I'll go through with my team and we'll edit all of the content that you give us for the newsletter. So, you know, I'll make sure it's grammatically correct. I'll make sure that, you know, it follows the typical protocols. Like we capitalize the word brother, for example, that's a standard for AAPI, but a lot of the chapters, you guys don't know that. So I'll go ahead and do that for you, make sure everything looks kosher on our end. And then once it's good to go, I'll go ahead and build the newsletter into Adobe Spark, which is the program we choose to use for all newsletters for you guys. Now, you guys are welcome to look at other avenues, other things, and maybe we can discuss that at some point during this webinar too. I'd love to hear what other resources you guys might be using. But if you're choosing to use Headquarters to build the newsletter for you, we'll use Adobe Spark to build it. And it's a great online interactive program, so you can include links and other things like that. And it's great to be able to have an online platform for your newsletter, in my opinion. So I'll build a newsletter for you guys. Once the newsletter is done, I will build it in an email to send over to you or the alumni chair, whoever is in contact with me. And then once you give me the go-ahead on the email and say that it's good to go, I'll send that email out to all of your chapter's alumni. And they'll be able to see the newsletter and open it. And usually the reply to has to be me, just because it has to be an AAPI domain for our email system. But I will usually forward any replies that I get about the newsletter to you guys so that you can see like if positive feedback came from an alumni or someone had a question that I obviously can't answer, I would forward it off to you guys. I'm really good about that. And I think it's, like I said, it's great that we can send it out to your alumni for you. A lot of you guys, generally speaking, don't have really in-depth like listservs of all your alumni, whereas we have anybody who's in our system with an email that went to your school will have to be able to send for you. So it's really convenient that we kind of do all the heavy lifting for you guys. The biggest portion of work for you will be creating all of the content. So now I kind of want to talk about what kind of content should be in a newsletter. So let's go back, we'll backtrack. And I want to kind of poll you guys and see what you think content-wise should be in your chapter newsletters, whether it's for alumni or parents. And again, you can post in the chat here, you can unmute yourself. I'd like to hear your opinions before I give some of my examples and things that I see typically in newsletters. And then I'll show you an example of a newsletter. So if anybody has any ideas of content, feel free to go ahead.
I'd say definitely philanthropy.
Yeah, philanthropy is great. I'm glad you brought that up, Dylan. Actually, so philanthropy is like a core value. I mean, you think of AAPI, Tikkun Olam is a huge value for our fraternity. So you want to show your alumni that you're giving back. Caleb just brought up a great idea, upcoming alumni events. That's great. You want to be able to connect with your alumni and show them what is upcoming for them in the semester that they can attend, whether it's, you know, a tailgate or maybe it's an initiation or, you know, a homecoming event. There are hundreds of different events you guys can create. to show your alumni, hey, you should come back and do X, Y, Z. And chances are they likely will. So great idea, Caleb. I loved that. Ben suggested chapter GPA, again, philanthropy and intramural sport events. Chapter GPA is actually really unique. If your chapter does really well on campus and academics, I highly suggest that you show your alumni or your audience members that you do well in academics, just because it shows them that, you know, you're hitting the books and you're not just, you know, going out there having a good time. Like, yes, the Brotherhood aspect is important, but you also want to show them what you're doing academically as well to show that you're successful. It's in, especially with alumni, because when it comes to alumni, they when it comes to like donations later, they're going to look back and say, okay, like, is this chapter successful right now? Like, or are they just a bunch of guys who are partying all the time? Because if they get that vibe, they likely don't want to give back or help you later. But if they see that you're a successful chapter, they're more likely to help you later. And intramural sports is great. I see a lot of chapters that do intramural sports. Like I said, though, it's not for every chapter. So don't feel like you have to do something with sports or sports related. Because I know, like, my chapter, Kent State, we did some intramurals, but we weren't really good. So I would never highlight that in a newsletter because I wouldn't really have much to write about for it. It's not like we ever went to championships. So those are all great ideas. Does anybody else have another idea of what you could write about in your newsletter before I give some other examples? Totally cool. If not, no worries. I appreciate those examples you guys did give. So Jewish programming is probably one of the biggest things I would say needs to be included in your newsletter. You know, whether it's if you guys did something for a Jewish holiday or, you know, I know things are kind of virtual right now. So if you guys are doing like maybe Shabbat dinners or, you know, just a, you know, even just a divar with each other for the week, I think taking a screenshot of that and including it in your newsletter to show that you guys are doing Jewish programming is great, especially with those older alumni who feel a connection to the Jewish fraternity. You definitely want to make sure that you're highlighting that aspect of your chapter among everything else. There could be other things too. It doesn't have to just be limited to events that you guys do with Jewish programming. It could be, you know, again, we have Shabbat Across AAPI in the fall. So if you guys do something with that, if you do one of our other Jewish programming year events, you could highlight that. It could be a brother's experience with Judaism, maybe letting them tell their story. Maybe a brother has a unique story. I definitely think that those are worthwhile things to talk about in your newsletter. And there's kind of no limit when it comes to Jewish programming. I don't want you to think that it just has to be an event. Some other examples, I definitely think you should include a letter from the master if you can. It should probably be the first thing the alumni see. Again, I'm using alumni as the example because that's typically the newsletter that I write, but it could be for parents or anybody else, any other audience member. But typically the first thing that I see in a newsletter that I make is a letter from the master, and it can just be an introduction saying like, hey, I'm the master. I started in November of 2019. You know, my vision for the chapter is this over the year. Things have been hard right now because of COVID-19. Here's how our chapter is continuing to come together. I think being transparent as the master and telling your audience what it is that your goals are is really important because you are the spokesperson as master for the entire chapter to those audience members, if you think about it in the broad spectrum. So I want to make sure that the voice of the chapter is being heard in some sense. So that's why I always suggest a letter from the master at some point. And then you have like brother updates. You could do, you know, maybe somebody's studying abroad. Right now, that's not really the case. But in general, if you have brothers studying abroad, you could maybe talk about their studying abroad experience. You could do like maybe if you guys are doing something interesting, I don't know, like maybe you're participating. Maybe a brother is participating in a campus event. Maybe he's a part of another student organization. You could highlight that with a brother update, brother achievements. Ben Cohen, great idea. Talk about brother achievements like internships they're doing right now. Andrew has a question. Go ahead, feel free. Go ahead and type it in or ask it if you have capabilities. I don't know if you can talk still, but feel free to type it if you can. We'll come back to Andrew when his question comes in. anyways, so brother updates in general are great. One thing I will say though is if you're going to do brother updates and if it's an alumni newsletter, I highly suggest that you do alumni spotlights or an alumni update, and you pick or choose one alumni per newsletter, whether it's semesterly, quarterly, whatever. You could do one or two guys just to highlight who they are, what they did in the chapter in their time, where they're at right now in life, and just a couple fun facts. It doesn't have to be really long, but usually like one or two paragraphs is perfect with a photo of them. The reason why I suggest doing an alumni spotlight and not just brother updates and things about the chapter. So if you think about the newsletter in general and your audience, if we're talking about alumni and an alumni newsletter, if you are specifically talking to alumni, it's great that you're talking about the current chapter, but a lot of the times they want to know about the guys that they were in the chapter with, and they care about what you guys are doing, don't get me wrong, but that content isn't necessarily applicable to them. So that's why I always suggest doing a spotlight of some sort, because it gives the alumni a chance to hear about guys that they might have known in the chapter, and a chance for them to have their voice heard. And it makes them feel more included in the chapter. So then again, you're kind of bringing them back in and giving them the opportunity to become a part of the chapter as is right now. Because a lot of alumni tend to distance themselves from the active chapter because they say, oh, I'm graduated. My opinion doesn't really matter anymore. But you still want them to feel included so that, again, they're more involved with you later, whether it's an event or donating, whatever it could be. So going to Andrew's question now. Andrew, you asked, how is the information applicable to startups? So I guess I'm kind of confused on what you mean. Are you saying that you want to highlight brothers who have startups? I think that's a great idea if you want to do that. Again, that could fall either into a brother highlight or an alumni spotlight, whatever it might be. But I'm not sure if that kind of works or if that's what you were getting at. You can let me know in the chat. But I'll come back to it if that doesn't answer your question. Other things that you guys can talk about in your newsletter, events the chapters participated in. I know, again, that the semester was kind of a different situation for you all, but maybe has your chapter attended or done anything that you think that you should touch on? Like convention's a great example. If you guys had chapter brothers that went to convention, have them talk about their experience, talk about what that was like, initiation, pledge inductions, maybe you recap on some of those things and talk about, what it was like for those brothers who got initiated, have them give a little recap on their experience. Maybe you guys did a leadership retreat. You might want to do a recap to your alumni or parents on what that leadership retreat was like. Maybe you guys went on a formal somewhere. Do you want to talk about that? Again, the possibilities are kind of endless with what you talk about. I just think when you're considering what needs to be included in the newsletter, you need to really hone in on what the audience is going to care about. At the end of the day, are your parents and alumni really going to care about your formal? Probably not. But if there was something cool that you guys did at the formal, like say you gave out awards, maybe you want to recap on the awards portion of the formal. That could be something great. Maybe we can include photos of the formal at some point. That could be a great example of something that we do that isn't necessarily just highlighting the event, that might not be as interesting. And then again, we get into upcoming events. I think it was Ben, no, it was Caleb, who gave upcoming events as something that you should touch on in the newsletter. And that's great. Again, think about what types of events the alumni can attend in a given semester, and make sure you include those upcoming events that you know of in your newsletter so that this way they have the chance to attend. And make sure you have a contact for them. Say, if you have any questions, contact so-and-so. And it could be, your general API email for your chapter. It could be a specific chapter brother. I'm not sure who you'd want them to contact. It could be the alumni chair, but whoever that person is, you should definitely have that contact in there at some point so they know who to reach out to. I talked about alumni spotlight. So I, once again, definitely make sure you do an alumni spotlight. So now I want to go ahead actually and show you some examples of newsletters that I've done for different chapters, just so you guys have an idea of what they look like. And then I'll go back and we'll backtrack again, and I'll show you kind of how to submit everything and what format that I usually prefer it in when it comes to my email. But again, if you have any questions, feel free to unmute yourself. I won't be able to see the chat for a minute while I share my screen, so we'll come back to this in a second. All right, so this is an example of Delta Deuteron's chapter newsletter that we did for them. In particular, I want to kind of scroll down. So they chose to do a letter to alumni to start the newsletter with, and then they chose to do a letter from the master afterwards. Sorry, I'm looking for the chat. I don't see the chat. Okay, so I can't answer questions right now. I was right. Anyways, so there's a letter from the master. And then they wanted to do a donation appeal right away in the newsletter. I strongly disagree with doing a donation appeal at the beginning of a newsletter. I think you should focus on the content first and then try to solicit them later if you're going to do a newsletter with an appeal, only because the first thing that the alumni see shouldn't be like an ask for money. But again, that's your choice. It's your newsletter. We'll do whatever you guys want, but that's just my opinion. And then this chapter chose to do like a highlight of the executive board. They did like a little, like who they were, you know, what they are doing in the chapter, what their position is, very basic. So you guys can choose to do like a meet the e-board if you want. They did like a highlight of their graduating brothers. They did a photo of them and then they listed all of them. They highlighted their philanthropy in Movember, had a photo of the guys who participated. I loved that. And then they actually had a website that they wanted to link out to for Movember, specifically for their link that they have for raising money. So I linked out to that in the newsletter for them. That's something that we can do with this newsletter. These are just stock photos, so you know, like these two photos were stock photos that I just found of their school. I posted in. I usually try to post in photos that I can find that they don't provide me, that chapters don't provide me. The philanthropy chair decided to do a little written piece on what he thinks the future of philanthropy is for their chapter. I liked that. One thing that I will point out, a lot of times when you talk to me about newsletters and what I think works versus doesn't, I think it's important to humanize the content. And what I mean by humanize is I think you should try to include perspectives from brothers of a particular situation. So if it's a philanthropy section that you're writing on, get the philanthropy chair's opinion, like we did here for this chapter. If it's a Jewish, you know, or Judaism section of the newsletter, try to get the Jewish chair or Israel engagement chair's perspective, because I think it's really important to hear what they have to say as that particular chair and like inserting their voice. It could be as simple as a quote of what they want to say. It could be the section is written by them and I can say like written by so-and-so brother, because I have done that. In this birthright recap that I did for Wayne State, it was written by their brother Alex McInnes. He wrote this whole section about studying abroad and what it was like to be on birthright. So, you know, that can be a way that you incorporate a more humanized voice for the piece. I think statistics are great when it comes to a philanthropy event or anything that you do. Numbers are really cool to see. Like, I love seeing how much you guys raise. But at the end of the day, again, think about the alumni and your audience members in general. Are they really going to care about, you know, how many sororities were there? Like, that's a great statistic and we love to see that. But maybe they want to hear from you guys what that event was like and what it meant to you and why you chose to do it. So just keep that in consideration when you're writing up each section of your newsletter. This was the section of Wayne State's that I wanted to show you, was the birthright recap. I thought this was unique to their Jewish section. They didn't specifically talk about a Jewish event. They had a brother recap about his birthright experience, and I loved that. And they gave me a photo of him with his 8-pack kippah on. I really liked that too. So this was what I wanted to show you from theirs. Tao Mu at Towson decided to do a brother highlight on Solomon Salkowitz, which was great. And then they did an alumni highlight on two different brothers, Jordan Schiff. So I inserted some photos of Jordan that I found from his Facebook, and this was the text they provided me. And then Matt Scher was another alumnus from their chapter who they highlighted. So they did that. They also did engagements too. A couple of their brothers had gotten engaged, so they chose to highlight those brothers. And I really like I said, that's unique. It's different. So I don't see all chapters do that. I kind of enjoy that. The reason I wanted to show you Pi Chapter's newsletter was actually because of the header photo that they gave me. You can tell that this photo looks really pixelated, so that was kind of an issue. They didn't have a better photo to go with. If you don't think you can get me a photo, that's fine. We should just choose to use a stock photo. Like Tao Mu's, for example, very clear photo, looks great. I can see everybody in it, doesn't look pixelated. That's a great photo to have as a header. Pies, you know, while I love their newsletter, this photo is just a little blurry for me. So I would have preferred if they could have taken a more modern photo, like a chapter photo together. I know it's a little hard for you guys right now in your chapters to be able to do this. But I will say that if you have an older chapter photo that's good, high quality, we can use that. In general, though, you should try to give me the highest quality photos as possible for every section. And a high quality photo doesn't have to be a photo taken on a professional camera. It could be something as simple as, you know, an iPhone photo, but just again, make sure that it's not really dark, that it isn't blurry in any way. If it is, you might want to try to consider getting a different photo of that brother or for that section. Photos aren't limited when it comes to, you know, everything that you give me. Like, a chapter can give me photos for all their e-board members and every section that they write. But if you have extra photos that you want to try to see if we can fit in somewhere, shoot them my way and I'll see what I can do. I don't think this chapter had any in particular photos that I did that with. Some chapters will just send me like 6 or 7 photos and say, hey, can you try to incorporate this? And I'll do what I can with incorporating it into the newsletter where I think it fits best. But again, it's kind of up to you guys. It's whatever you give me. So that's kind of the overlook of how newsletters look. A couple things that I think I forgot to mention in the newsletter, I'll always include a section at the bottom about future events, even if you don't have anything, just so that there's a section for it living on your newsletter. I'll usually include a section, let's see if TauMuse has it, because I don't think they, okay. So TauMuse actually did, they had like check back for upcoming events, you know, contact V Herman, who was their master, if you have interest in attending a game that they were having. Another section that I usually include in every newsletter is a chapter eternal, marriages and birth. You don't have to worry about pulling anything for this section. I'll pull all this information for you. I just think, again, depending on your audience, if it's an alumni newsletter, it's really important that they see if anybody entered Chapter Eternal in the year, if anybody got married that we know of, and births. And then I always make a little ask at the bottom saying, if they have any notifications that aren't here, please email me so that, you know, they can get us that information and we can update it. And then TauMu chose to do the approach that I had suggested that Delta Deuteron did not do. They did their chapter ask for money at the very bottom, and I inserted this stock photo for them. They had a donation form, and they had a contact, so like I added all this in there for them. Another thing that you should probably consider adding into your newsletter, which I'll try to insert for you, is just like a follow us on whatever social media you guys have, whether it's Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, if it's a website you guys have. We can make social media buttons like this, and then when you click it, it'll automatically just go to that chapter's social media, which is pretty convenient. I like being able to connect the alumni with you guys via social media if we can. So that kind of covers like the examples of newsletters that I've made. I'm gonna pause there for a second and stop sharing my screen. Does anybody have any questions? I don't see any in the box, but do any of you have any questions about content or how the newsletter looks before I backtrack again? And I'm going to talk about how to submit content to me. All right. Seeing none, hearing none, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen one more time. And this time, I'm going to show you guys the newsletter folder that I typically make. I'll send this to you guys, like I said, in my follow-up email today or tomorrow whenever I get it to you guys. But this is kind of like the example folder of what I'd like you guys to share it. I prefer when you guys share everything with me via Google Drive versus sharing it with me via Microsoft Word, for example. Word is great to write in, but I hate when people put photos in the newsletter. It tends to look really, it's hard for me to pull those photos from a Word document. It usually diminishes the quality of the photo. So I prefer when the content is like the document for the content is here, and then you attach the images in the folder as well. And then you just share the folder with me by clicking share and then typing in my email, thugo@api.org. So I'll show you the content document that I have. Let's see where that is. So this is the content document that I started as like an example. Put your chapter or school name so that I know it's yours. Try to list out the sections and what you want them named. So like if it's the letter from the master, call it the letter from the master. If it's Jewish programming, call it that. Or like say you want to say like, call it something else. You know, like sports, for example. If it's sports and you don't want to call it sports, you want to call it IM League let me know that it's called I Am League, because I won't know that if you don't tell me. If it's written by a brother, make sure you tell me which brother helped you write that section so I can give them credit. I think it's really important to give your brothers credit for the work they do to help with the newsletter. And then write all of the text for that newsletter section underneath. And then if there's a photo that goes with the newsletter section, make sure you tell me what the photo file name is that's in the folder that we talked about. So in this case, for this section, the letter from the master, I said the photo file was image 2025. And if you look, this is image 2025. So I know when I'm building this for you guys, this is the image I have to use for that section. So just keep that in mind. Try to make that as clear as possible. I don't want to screw anything up for you all. But that's pretty much it with like the content of like how I want it submitted. Again, you can just share it with me afterwards. If I have any questions, I'll let you know. If you have extra photos that you don't know what to do with, but you want to see if I can include, just put them in that folder and say, hey, like there are a couple extra photos in there you might find, see what you can do with them. And then we can go from there and see like what it is, you know, that we can do with it. But that's pretty much it when it comes to the newsletter content. I meant to show you, this is what the general layout looks like for the email that goes out to your alumni from I make it from you guys. In this case, I forgot to change it for Beta New, but it'll say get the latest your chapter designation news. And then I'll make it come from AEPI. If it's Beta New, it would say AEPI Beta New. So that when alumni get it, it doesn't just look like another headquarters email. It looks like an email that came from the chapter. And I sign it off from the brothers of your chapter so that they know. And then in the newsletter, I'll include a link to the issue that links out to the general newsletter, as I've shown you. There will be a button to it as well. And then there's also going to be a photo of the top of the newsletter. So whatever your top image is for that newsletter will be the header image in this email. And then, like I said, once this is done and I build it, I'll send it to you guys as chapters. Make sure you're okay with it. If you're good to go and everything looks kosher, I'll email it out to the alumni. Typical lead times that it takes me to get a newsletter done. I used to be able to do newsletters in 1 to 2 weeks for you all. Now it takes about anywhere from 2 to 3 weeks, if I'm being honest. Things are kind of crazy right now, as you can all imagine. So just be patient with me. If you know that you want to get it out in like 3 weeks, make sure you give me plenty of time to get that done. Make sure you get the content to me 3 weeks before. But just kind of keep an open communication with me. I'll make sure that I can do what I can to get everything done as fast as I can for you all, because I'm here to serve you. That's my job. But that kind of covers it for my content. Does anybody, if you want to unmute yourself again and ask questions, it looks like we had somebody join, Russell. I didn't give you the chance to talk. I'm sorry, now you can if you want to. But feel free to unmute yourself, ask questions, give ideas. You can jump in the chat with any questions, and I'm going to check in to see if there's anything that I'm missing. Dylan, thanks. I'm glad you like the newsletter layout. I'm being serious. It depends on the quality of the photos that you get me and the content that you give me. The better the content and the more humanized that the content is rather than just very robotic, the better the newsletter looks in the end. And I've gotten great feedback from alumni. That's why I've continued with Adobe Spark, because they say how much they love this format. I haven't gotten any complaints saying, oh, like this should be a PDF, or, you know, oh, this should be print. A lot of them really honestly don't care. And especially right now with everything COVID, I think it just makes sense for it to be online. Talked about the newsletter content, talked about humanizing. I know this is kind of obvious, but make sure that your photos are appropriate. I'll check everything before I insert it into the newsletter, but if you choose to make your own newsletter, just make sure that you're not posting photos of anything, you know, that could get you in trouble. If you have to think about it, it likely isn't appropriate for your newsletter. And again, don't assume that, I've had conversations with chapters about this before when making a newsletter. Don't assume that because it's going to a specific audience, so if it's built for alumni, don't assume that the alumni are the only people that are ever going to see it. So if you're including something in there that, you know, might offend somebody outside of your chapter or alumni group, maybe you should not be including that at all. Just keep that in mind. I don't want you guys getting in trouble for anything that you're posting in your newsletters. Another piece of advice that I had for you guys when it comes to your newsletters is follow up with a small group of alumni, maybe guys that are closer to your age that may have just graduated. See what they think of the newsletter. Maybe give them a survey to poll them and see what they think of it. But I think including your alumni or your parents, doesn't matter what the audience is, to ask them what their thoughts are on the content that you created will help you develop a better newsletter the next time. And you can say, okay, well, our research group said XYZ about the newsletter, so we're not going to include this section because they didn't like that section in the last one. And don't just assume because people hated it that it should be cut altogether. Maybe try to ask follow-up questions. If they didn't like it, say, why didn't you like it? And choose to see, maybe it was, you know, the topic, maybe it was, there could be a number of things. So just keep that in mind of following up with alumni or parents or whomever your audience is to see what their reaction is to what you're sending them to make sure it's something they actually want. Talked about social media. Right now, I think it's kind of cool. This is the one time I'm going to say COVID is cool because we're in this time period where we get to interact with our alumni on a level we've never been able to before. So if your chapters are thinking about budgeting for Zoom accounts or anything in the fall, or if you have free tools you can use to create chapter hangouts where you can invite alumni, I think that's a great opportunity for you to put that in your newsletter and say, we're having a meetup on XYZ date. For alumni, a virtual meetup, we would love to have you there, and we can link out to the registration page for that meetup in your newsletter. So just to kind of spark some ideas of things that you can do. That was another one that I wanted to make sure that I gave you. And I think the last piece of advice I really have, honestly, is just if you have multiple people helping you with a newsletter, make sure you give deadlines. It's really important that you give deadlines. If you want to have everything written and done in a month and you have six people helping you, make sure they know what that date and time is that they have to get you everything so you can hold them accountable when they don't get it to you. You shouldn't have to wait on two out of six brothers to get you the content that you need to get the newsletter out because it's just going to delay your process. So you tell your brothers, get me your information by June 15th. If you do not, it's not going to be included in the next newsletter. And then when they come back to you and say, why wasn't my stuff included? You can go, bro, I told you it was due this date and I had nothing from you before then. So again, it's just accountability and making sure they know what their deadlines are because you don't want to leave loose ends in your deadlines. But again, I think that's all I really had for you guys. I know I went over a lot of information, but does anybody have any questions, anything I can address? Ideas you guys have, things you want to know when it comes to newsletters that I've seen while working with chapters. I would love to pick your brains and help you as much as I can right now. If not, I'll give it a minute, but if not, make sure you guys take a minute to fill out the survey. You guys will get a survey link tomorrow, or you'll see in the pop-up window from Zoom after you log out of this, that there's a survey for this session. I'd love if you guys could take a few minutes to fill that out. It helps me as a staff member know what you guys are interested in and what helps you. So I would love if you could take a few minutes to do that. We have some other programs this week as well. If you go to API Connect, you can check those out and see if any other sessions kind of apply to you this week that you'd be interested in. But yeah, does anybody else have anything? Any other questions for me? All right, not really hearing anything. So I guess you guys are good to go then. Thanks so much for attending today. I appreciate it. And I really hope that you learned something new with the newsletter stuff. I really look forward to working with you guys if I haven't before on your newsletter. This is kind of one of my favorite parts of AAPI. So I love getting the chance to tell your chapter story to your alumni. So this is gonna be fun. I'm really looking forward to touching base with you guys later on. And I will follow up with you all tomorrow, again, with some of these resources that I gave you today via share screen so that you can see and get that content to me. So thank you all so much. Take care.